Hello, everybody. This is Martin Wing speaking from Bosch Security Systems in Eindhoven. I'm here today together with my colleague Jan Peter Smolders again. This is the follow-up session for loudspeaker basics on how to read the data sheet and interpret specifications. So Jan Peter, application engineer based in Eindhoven. We are basically going through the basics from PA. We already did a few sessions. So this is the second one that is around the loudspeaker selection and how to interpret the data sheet. So Jan Peter, the floor is yours.
Okay, thanks, Martin. Yeah, welcome everybody to this second part of how to read a loudspeaker data sheet. The objective is to know what a loudspeaker can do. So whatever you want to do in an application and you need a loudspeaker for that, you should know what that loudspeaker can do. So you understand the specifications for your specific application where to use your loudspeaker. And today's topics, we're gonna have a small recap of the first part of this webinar we had last week. Then we're going to continue with the data sheet, specifications, installation, environment, and accessories. So what did we discuss last week? We started with the type of loudspeakers. There are different types of loudspeakers. For instance, ceiling loudspeakers, cabinet loudspeakers, column loudspeakers, line arrays, sound projectors, and horns. Now, all these loudspeakers have different specifications. You can use them in different applications. So it's good to know how they can perform and where you can use them. So like I said, yeah, it's important to know what the technical specifications are. And yeah, you have to understand these specifications. So yeah, you know what I mean, and you where you can use them. Main subjects, specification, installation, environment, and accessories. These subjects you also find in our data sheets. Now we looked at electrical definitions, the rated power, our 100 volt loudspeakers rated power, the nominal power they can deliver. Actually, the transformer can handle. Sound pressure levels, typical for each environment, like you see here on the right, 65 dB in an office, for instance. Those SPL levels of a loudspeaker are measured by the IEC standard at 1 watt, one meter on axis of a loudspeaker, as you see here on the right. And we also talked about the relation of the distance to the loudspeaker. When you double the distance, if you go twice as far from a certain point of a loudspeaker, then the sound pressure level will be reduced with 6 dB for a point source. So the loudspeaker, single loudspeaker, like you see here on the right, and minus 3 dB for line sources like columns and arrays. We also looked at the frequency response. Yeah, it's important to know how well a loudspeaker can reproduce frequencies at certain sound pressure levels. The best response would be a flat line from a horizontal line from left to right to all the frequency spectrum. But those loudspeakers don't exist. Then we had some theory about sound, some fundamental frequencies. Every object has its own frequencies, voices and instruments. And then we looked at the harmonics and overtones, which they define the timbre or how things sound. So we can recognize the person talking or the specific instrument playing. And then we looked at the two examples of the frequency response of a horn loudspeaker, like you see here on the right, and a sound system you see on the right side as well. So these frequency responses differ a lot. The horn loudspeaker not so good for music, while the sound system has large coverage also in the low area and the high area. Good for music. And then finally, we looked at the relation of a frequency response of a loudspeaker and the requirements in the EN54. And if you remember the blue line there, that loudspeaker is falling into the gray area. It's not covering the sound pressure levels of all frequencies up to 8,000 hertz in a certain range. So that will not be certified, those loudspeakers. Okay, then let's continue with the specifications. Sound pressure level in relation to intelligibility. Well, noise has a lot of influence on speech intelligibility. Speech intelligibility is important for our voice alarm systems, of course. Now, in order to reach a good speech intelligibility, the signal to noise ratio, so the signal that is coming out of the audio signal that's coming out of a loudspeaker, which you can measure on ear level where people are standing in relation to the noise and the environment, like for instance, you have on a railway platform when a train is passing by or of a heavy factory where you can have a lot of noise. Now the signal to noise ratio, if that is 15 dB, so if the signal is 15 dB higher than the noise, than the environment noise, then the noise has no influence on the speech intelligibility. For a good intelligibility, speech intelligibility, you need at least 10 dB. So for instance, if you have a noise level of 62 dB in a room or in an environment where you are, then the system, the sound system, must be able to deliver at least 72 dB sound pressure level at ear height. You can measure those things. So that's a good rule to when you're in installing, or let's say if you're making an application for a certain building, make sure that your sound level at ear height is at least 10 dB higher than the noise in that environment. A high SPL you can get from horns. Horns typically can deliver high sound pressure levels. Yeah, you see horns a lot in parking lots and sport complexes outdoors. Without foreground music, a horn is not so good for music. Then cabinet and column loudspeakers are also able to deliver high SPLs, where cabinet loudspeakers, they're used normally indoors. Pro Sound, you can see them also outdoors, festivals and stuff like that. They can deliver also higher SPLs, and they can deliver good music. So foreground music, use a cabinet loudspeaker in a bar or a shop or something like that. Column loudspeakers are often used in larger rooms. Auditoriums, for instance, or churches, you see them a lot, where speech is important. So in those kind of environments, the choice of a column is a good choice. Then pendant sound projectors, you see here a picture on the right. With a pendant loudspeaker, you can reduce the distance from the loudspeaker to the listening plane. So you can hang them on a ceiling, mount them on a ceiling, so the loudspeaker will be closer to your ears, actually. So you can also, by means of a pendant loudspeaker, you can choose a loudspeaker with a lower SPL, with a lower sound pressure level. Now we have a very nice pendant loudspeaker, it's called the Hemi. It can cover larger areas, like for instance warehouses or mega stores, big show stores, even swimming pools. So with this loudspeaker, this big loudspeaker, you can cover an area where you would else need maybe 10 or 20 loudspeakers to cover that whole area. So for installations, this is larger installations, this would be a good choice. Now let's look at an example how the sound pressure level of a loudspeaker relates to a certain environment. I have chosen two examples, one of an office and the other one of a shopping mall. Now let's assume the office has a ceiling height of 3.2 meters and the shopping mall has a ceiling height of 5.6 meters. So that means the listening height of the in the office where people are sitting is 1.2 meters. So people are sitting from the floor, it's 1.2 meters. And in the shopping mall where people are standing, the listening height is 1.6 meters. Now they've measured the noise levels in these in these buildings. The noise level in the office was 74 dB and in the shopping mall it was 84 dB. You can measure in an office, you can have air conditioning, you can have maybe printers or whatever, people talking on the phone. So that's the noise level of an office. In a shopping mall, you also have, of course, people walking around and talking. And the noise level there was 84 dB. Now, what that, does that mean for the loudspeaker? It means that the loudspeaker, if it is mounted in the ceiling in the office, it will have to cover 2 meter distance from the loudspeaker to the listening area where people are sitting. So that's 1.2 meters. So 3.2 meters minus 1.2 is 2 meters. So the loudspeaker will have to be able to deliver at least 84 dB at listening height in an office. Remember, the sound pressure level will be reduced with 6 dB when you double the distance. So if we are going to look at the actual sound pressure level that the loudspeaker should be able to reproduce, then we have to add for the office 6 dB. So that means that this loudspeaker will have to be able to deliver 90 dB. So the specification of that loudspeaker when at full power should be at least 90 dB. And if you look at the shopping mall, where we will have to be able to deliver at least 94 dB at listening height and the distance is 4 meters, that means that you will have to add up 12 dB more, right? So you go from 1 meter to 2 meters, that's plus 6 dB. From 2 meters to 4 meters, that's plus 6 dB or minus 6 dB. You will have an additional 12 dB required at the loudspeaker. So the loudspeaker that you will use in the shopping mall, if it's mounted in the ceiling, you will need at least 106 dB. So let's look then at the loudspeaker, the choice of loudspeaker for the office. So we just calculated that the loudspeaker will have to be able to deliver at least 90 dB maximum sound pressure level at 1 meter. Now I've chosen three loudspeakers that will comply to this 90 dB at least. The first one is the LHM0606, that's a 6-watt loudspeaker, which can deliver 94 dB at 1 meter distance. So that will be sufficient. Then two other loudspeakers. The first one is the LC3. The LC3, we have two versions. It's also a 6-watt loudspeaker, and that one is also EN54 certified. And the LC5. The LC5 is a spotlight loudspeaker. It's a very small one, a very nice loudspeaker, also EN54 certified. And another thing, what I should mention here as well, they're all 6-watt loudspeakers. And as you know, these loudspeakers on the transformers, they are tapping. So you could also reduce the power by tapping them down. Now, when you do that, be aware that it will each tap will reduce the power with 50%, but then you will also use 3 dB of sound pressure level. So the LHM0606 and the LC3 will be able to be tapped down to 3 watts, because then you will have still 91 dB left for that loudspeaker. But the LC5 already is at the limit, so that we cannot use the LC5 at the lower tapping, because then you will not have sufficient sound pressure level left. Now, if we look at the shopping mall, there we would need a quite high sound pressure level due to the distance and due to the high ceiling. Now, the choice of loudspeakers there would be, or could be, the LBC3099. This is a ceiling speaker which can deliver 106 dB at 1 meter. Then the LC6, that's actually kind of a sound system with a larger loudspeaker, which can deliver 114 dB, and the LC20, that's a premium loudspeaker, which can also deliver a high sound pressure level of 113 dB. And this loudspeaker is also EN54 certified. Now, another choice could also be a pendant loudspeaker. Like I just said, a pendant loudspeaker will bring the sound closer to the listening plane. So, for instance, LBC3095, LS1, LP6, and the Hemi, we have already seen, which are pendant loudspeakers, could also be used here. And then you can choose a loudspeaker that can deliver a lower sound pressure level because it's closer to the ears. The distance to the loudspeaker then will be smaller. We also have the LC1, which can be used as a pendant loudspeaker, because we have some accessories for that, a suspension kit and a mounting box, where you can connect the LC1 in, and so you can then also use this loudspeaker as a pendant loudspeaker. Next thing, we are going to look at the acoustical performance of a loudspeaker. These loudspeakers, the specifications, the sound pressure levels are all measured in anechoic rooms. And then with microphones, they measure the sound pressure level with pink noise that is coming out of the loudspeaker. As you see here on the right side, we see the anechoic room we have here in Eindhoven, with the ceiling speaker installed in the wall. And in front of it, you see a measuring device that can turn around the loudspeaker at 180 degrees. If you look at the picture here on the right, this loudspeaker, or the microphone will move around the loudspeaker and measure at all these instances here the sound pressure level, so in 180 degrees. And the results of these measurements are plotted in a polar diagram, or a polar plot. Now let's have a look at that. Polar plots look like this. So here, like you see here on the right side. So what you have to do, you have to imagine there is this loudspeaker that we have measured right here in the middle of the polar plot. And then on the outside here, on axis, you will see the position of the loudspeaker in degrees. So where you look at zero degrees, that's on axis. So that's straight in front of the loudspeaker. And then if you move around it, you can see the angle of the position of the measurement outside the loudspeaker, and that goes around 360 degrees. Now in the middle here, on the vertical axis, you will see the measured sound pressure level of the position of the microphone around the loudspeaker, and that is plotted inside this graph. So if you look here for a 360 degree rotation around the loudspeaker as an example, you can see at all these octaves, 125, 250, 500, 1000, 2000, 4000, 8000 hertz. They're all plotted inside this diagram. And here it's obvious that the higher the frequencies, the smaller the angles become, right? The sound pressure level for instance, 8,000 hertz is getting really small, right? The sound pressure level decreases a lot already at 10 or 20 degrees here. See that? So this is how you can read a polar plot, or how it's plotted actually. Yeah, one remark here, the measurement for a ceiling loudspeaker is not done, it's only done in the front of the loudspeaker, of course. Yeah? So in the area here where you see for instance, for a cabinet loudspeaker like this, this part for a ceiling speaker is not measured because it's not relevant for the sound that is coming out of it. So let's look at an example then, how to look at the how to look at the opening angle, how to calculate the opening angle from a polar plot. You see here an example where you see, for instance, four octaves, 1,000, 2,000, and 4,000 hertz. Now, if we look at the 4,000 hertz example, so the big gray line over here, we have to look for the minus 6 dB points in the plot. Those are the points where the and that's the definition actually of the opening or coverage angle at minus 6 dB. So if you look at those points here, so you look at the circus minus 5 or minus 6 here underneath, and you go down, you find this the cross point over here, and you go to the right, you find the cross point over there, that's minus 6 dB. Then you draw a line to the outside, and then you look at which angle you still have minus 6 dB. And here it's about 47 degrees. So in total, the opening angle of this loudspeaker at 4,000 hertz will be 94 degrees. Now, if you look at the specifications then and the relation to the sound pressure level, just to show where that sound pressure level can be measured, we measure the sound pressure level at 1 watt, 1 meter from the loudspeaker. Now for the opening angle, we look at the minus 6 dB level of that loudspeaker. And you see in this example over here, it has an opening angle of 145 degrees. Then the minus 6 dB point is over here, also at 1 meter from the distance from the loudspeaker. So at this point, the loudspeaker can still deliver 84 dB. So it's 90 dB minus 6 is 84 dB. Now, as we already have seen in the polar plots, the opening angle or coverage angle is highly depending on frequencies. The higher the frequency, the more directive a loudspeaker will become. So the smaller the opening angle will become. In this example, here on the right here, you can see at 1,000 hertz, the opening angle is 145 degrees, and at 4,000 hertz, the opening angle is 130 degrees. So that means if you look at the coverage that the loudspeaker at 1,000 hertz can cover a larger area compared to the loudspeaker coverage at 4,000 hertz. So this area is smaller. So keep that in mind. We know that for voice, the frequencies 1,000 and 4,000 hertz are quite important. So if you have to calculate, or if you have to know how a loudspeaker performs and what the coverage is of that loudspeaker at certain frequencies, you have to look at these coverage angles. A good example of a directive loudspeaker, so where you can aim actually the sound beam to the audience, to the listening plane, is a column loudspeaker, like you see here on the right. You can aim it where the people are sitting or standing. This is also good for the room acoustics, of course. You can imagine if this was a larger opening angle in the vertical plane, then the sound would also go to the ceiling and come back, so you have a lot of reflections. And by doing this, so a smaller opening angle over here, you will prevent those reflections. So the sound is only going to the listening pane where people are sitting. Then you can see in the specifications that you have a vertical opening angle and a horizontal one. So the horizontal for the room in the horizontal plane, and the vertical one for the vertical plane. Now let's look at an example of a loudspeaker installation, looking at the opening angles in a ceiling, in a corridor, in an office, for instance. Now you can see here where the person is walking here at listening height, with the installation of those loudspeakers, that you will have gaps here, right? So this will cover still minus 6 dB, and then here the sound pressure level goes down, so you will have a gap here and you will have a gap over there. Now how can you solve this? You could solve this, of course, by installing additional loudspeakers. So another loudspeaker here to cover this gap and a loudspeaker there to cover that gap. That would mean that for this corridor you would need 5 loudspeakers. You could also use loudspeakers with a larger opening angle. Yeah, you can imagine if the lower the ceiling, the bigger these gaps are, the more loudspeakers you would need to cover the whole area on the listening plane. So a good choice could be a loudspeaker with a larger opening angle. What you see in here in this picture here on the right, we have now 2 loudspeakers with a larger opening area, which can cover the whole listening plane in this corridor. So this will save you the amount of loudspeakers, the insulation, so the cost will be reduced with such a solution. Now, something about sizes and types. The physical behavior of a loudspeaker or a driver, a single driver, this is a driver and this is a driver, is depending on the frequency. So the size and frequencies relate. A small driver can be used for higher frequencies and a larger driver for lower frequencies. This is just a physical thing. A larger driver will be able to move in a slower pace to the outside compared to a smaller driver. So a combination of drivers, like you see here on the right, like a tweeter and a woofer for the high and a woofer for the low frequencies, will improve the frequency response. We have seen that already with the sound system, where we had a dedicated subwoofer and satellite speaker for the high frequencies. Now in a cabinet loudspeaker, you can do basically the same and combine those two together, which will improve actually the frequency response. Now there are different types of drivers used in different types of loudspeakers. A single driver, a single loudspeaker, we see in ceilings or in ceiling loudspeaker or horns. And then two-way loudspeakers, so two drivers in one cabinet, cabinet loudspeakers. Dual cone drivers, these are single drivers, but they have 2 cones. You see this is the larger cone and the smaller cone. So they have in the middle, they have an additional cone. You see those in columns and lineways and ceilings. This will improve also the opening angle of this loudspeaker. Then coaxial drivers. If you look at the picture here, there are actually 2 drivers where a smaller driver is positioned in the middle of the larger driver. We see those in columns and line arrays, sometimes ceiling speakers. We have it, for instance, in the Vari line array. We use these kind of drivers. Then cross cone technology. Those are very shallow loudspeakers. You see them in cars, for instance. Those are very small, shallow loudspeakers. with large opening angles. Our LC4, for instance, has this type of loudspeaker. Now let's look at the installation of a loudspeaker. When you install a loudspeaker, you have to look at the rated voltage. We are using for our voice alarm systems 100 volt loudspeakers. The advantage is that you can connect or install all these loudspeakers in parallel. You don't have to calculate anything for those low impedances and how much power. You only have to know how much power your amplifier can deliver and how much power your loudspeakers will have. You can add them all up just to match the loudspeaker. So that's convenient. 100 volt loudspeakers can also connect to a 70 volt amplifier. Be aware that 70 volts have the power. So if you do that, the loudspeaker can deliver a sound pressure level which is reduced with 3 dB. So keep that in mind. And we also have taps. Taps are also mentioned in the data sheet. Each tap will reduce the power of the loudspeaker by 50%. So here in this example, you see that this loudspeaker has three taps, and the lowest value will be then 2.5 watts. So it's a 10 watt loudspeaker. Three taps going from 10 to 5 to 2.5 watts. And also here, keep in mind that the sound pressure level will be reduced. If you tap it down with to have the power, it will be reduced with 3 dB. Now, also in the data sheets, you will also find the mounting method for ceiling speakers. There are different mounting methods available, like for instance slider clips, springs, and screws and clamps. Our LC1 has, let's say, a nice method with springs. So that means that you can pull it down. You can pull down the loudspeaker while it's still hanging down the ceiling, and you can connect the wires and then pull it back again. So that's a nice way of mounting a loudspeaker. Then other parameters to consider are the mounting depth. Our LC2, LC20s are quite big loudspeakers, so keep in mind that you will need some room below the ceiling to be able to mount those loudspeakers. Also, cutout size, how big the hole should be where you will mount the loudspeaker in. Now, this is the example of the accessory for an LC1, for instance, where we have a back box and a chain to mount its pendant to the ceiling, or a back box to mount it to a wall, for instance. Now, the LC6, the ceiling speaker, also has a pendant version, LP6, that looks like this, where the back box is already mounted on it. And some projectors also can be used as pendant loudspeakers, like, for instance, you see here on the right, the LS1. Now, if you look at the environment, there are some specifications related to the environment. For instance, the IP rating, the ingress protection rating. Now, what does that mean? It's referring to the protection offered to electrical enclosure against solid objects and liquids. So how well, it's just an indication how well a loudspeaker is protected to objects that are going through it, and liquids like rain or water. If you look at the tables in more detail, if you have, for instance, a loudspeaker which has an IP rating of 32, the first number is related to the protection against solid objects. So the tree will say, okay, it's protected against solid objects over 2.5 millimeters, like tools and wires and stuff like that. And the second one, the second number is indicating the protection against liquids. So this loudspeaker has a protection against direct sprays of water up to 15 degrees from the vertical. So water sprays directly into the loudspeaker. If you look at the IP ratings of different loudspeakers, in general indication, we can see that ceiling loudspeakers, if you look at the second number, ceiling loudspeakers have quite a low number, so generally not used outdoors. And then we see line arrays, cabinets, columns and sound projectors, and especially horns, which have a rating of 7, up to 7, which can be very well used outdoors. We also see the relation of IP back at the EN54 rating. So if the loudspeaker is EN54 certified, you see there also the rating of IP coming back to this to the certification. A type A certification, generally for indoor use, the IP rating will have to be at least 21. And the type B rating for generally for outdoor use, the IP rating has to be at least 33. So looking at all these environmental ratings, we've looked at the EN54, the IP rating, but there's also a ballproof rating. The rating for loudspeakers you can use for instance in the sports hall, a mechanical impact IQ rating, salt resistance. This is quite important if you are installing loudspeakers near the sea or on a ship or offshore. Make sure that these loudspeakers are salt resistant, so they have an NSCL certificate. Then ammonia resistant for the chemical industry. Wind force, some loudspeaker can be tested for wind force. Then you will see, like here, you'll see the numbers 11.4, which is quite a high wind. It goes up to 12 where you have a hurricane. Chlorine resistant, really important one for swimming pools. You have to keep in mind that chlorine affects the metal parts, so also the mounting parts of those loudspeakers. And you can imagine if a loudspeaker falls down from the ceiling, it could injure people really bad. So make sure if you want to install a loudspeaker inside of a swimming pool where there's chlorine, make sure it's chlorine tested. UV resistance, the influence of the sun to a loudspeaker. And then one specific rating, also the ATEX rating, that's explosion proof rating. These loudspeakers with this EX mark on it, they can be used in areas with a risk of gas or dust explosions. Now, what does it mean? It means that the enclosure of the loudspeaker is totally sealed. So there cannot be any gas inside that loudspeaker, just to prevent that an electrical spark inside the loudspeaker would cause an explosion. So if you have areas with high risk of gas or dust explosions, you have to look for the for loudspeakers with an EX standard certificate. Okay, last thing to discuss, accessories. For ceiling loudspeakers, we have, for instance, a back box. This back box can be put on the back of the loudspeaker just to prevent the speaker against dust, for instance. And the fire dome. Now, fire dome is an important accessory to use with ceiling loudspeakers just to prevent, in case of a fire, that the fire will also spread below the ceiling. So that's what we can use a fire dome for. And also note that some of these loudspeakers are EN54 certified in combination with a black box or a fire dome. So be aware of that. Look in the data sheet and check if you would need a black box or a fire dome for the EN54 certification. Another accessory is the ceramic connection adapter you see here on the right. It's a triple ceramic screw terminal block with a terminal fuse mounted on it. You can connect these in series with the 100 volt primary connection of a loudspeaker and an amplifier or the loudspeaker line. Now, what happens if in case of a fire, damage to the loudspeaker will not result in a failure of the circuit that is connected to it, because the thermal fuse will blow and it will disconnect the loudspeaker. Yeah, well, this can replace a connection terminal, or it can be mounted in a connection box. Also be aware that it's not mandatory for EN54-24, because the standard EN54 standard provides that the speakers can burn, but that the DPA system, so the voice alarm system, should be able to detect a problem on the loudspeaker line and provide the line fault within these 100 seconds, which is specified in the standard. So it's not mandatory for EN54. Okay, Maarten, that was it. Are there any questions?
Yeah, thank you, Jan-Pieter. There are a few questions. There were a few comments from ProTech in the Netherlands, but I think those topics were covered. It was a bit about frequency band, 1 kilohertz, and there were some graphs in your presentation afterwards. So if there is still an open question, please repost it. Then there is another one. If the IP ratings for the loudspeakers, if they can be found if there is another document to find them, because they are not in the data sheet, it seems. I don't know if you know this, Jan-Pieter.
No, the IP rating should be there. If it's tested for it, the IP rating should be there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I just opened the data sheet. I don't see the symbols at least. Indeed.
Yeah, look at the environmental part, and if it's tested there, then it should be there. If it's important for loudspeaker light, let's look at the LB2s maybe.
Yeah, I have here listed it.
Have a look with you.
Shall I share my screen?
Yeah, you can do that. Just a minute.
Need to become presenter for a second. Okay, and then I share my screen.
Now, maybe a better example is the LB20s, Maarten. Okay. 5 inch, I'll look with you.
Okay. Yeah. So this is let me see. This is the LB1. Not sure if this has an environmental.
Let me have a look.
Here it is stating operating temperature, storage and transport, but it doesn't say the IP rating. Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah,
maybe.
If it's not tested for it, then you will not see the rating. But if you look at, for instance, an LB20, the 5-inch LB20s, you can see already. Shall I take the screen back, Maarten?
Yeah.
Where am I here?
Make you presenter again. Yeah, you can share now, Jan-Pieter.
Okay, here on on the product catalog, you have, if you look at loudspeakers, you immediately have an overview of the specifications. Can you see my screen now?
Yeah, I see the screen. Yeah.
Okay. Now, for instance, I know for the LB20, for this loudspeaker, the IP rating is specified because you can use this one outdoors. If you look down here, so you have immediately on the product catalog, you will have an overview of the key specifications, so to speak, here, technical specifications. And if you go down, you see here environmental, it says IP rating of 54. So the outdoor rating is 4. So that's where you can see it. So if it is tested for ingress protection, then it should be stated in the data sheet.
Okay, thank you, Jan-Pieter. Next question, the UV rating, is the UV rating only important for color changing, or has UV also influence on technical items in the speaker?
Yeah, well, it's mainly for the color, right? It will colorize the it will change the color of ABS, for instance, plastics.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah,
it's not known to me that it will also have influence on the performance of a loudspeaker.
Yeah. Those were the questions. No open questions anymore. So if somebody still wants to post something, take your chance. If not, I would like to thank everybody for your attention and hope to see you on the next webinar, where we will talk about the next topic. What is it, Jan-Pieter? I see here the 9th of December. Again, a session, how to select the right loudspeaker for your project. So what is it about?
Yeah, how to make the right choice. We have also some tools how to look at loudspeaker specifications easily. We have an app, so we go into a bit more detail on how to make the proper selection for a loudspeaker.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, now another question still comes in. I have an ammunition dump in an old mine with a high sulfur content. Both seawater proof speakers as well as IP and chlorine resistant speakers break relatively quickly there. We won't know exactly why. Do you have experience, and I think, do you have an advice?
Whoa, yeah, no, to be honest, I've never heard of that. Sorry. This is really specific.
Yeah.
No, to be honest, I don't know.
No. Okay. Okay, then if there are no more questions, thank you all for joining. Hope to see you on the next webinar, and I wish you all a good day. Thank you. Bye-bye.